we've got some crucial stuff, some important stuff to Niagara County here. We have the three executive directors of the largest facilities that provide service to the disabled. We have Jeff Sanderson with River Shore, we have Connie Brown with Opportunities Unlimited, and John Reardon with NCP. Last week there was a press conference with a lot of elected officials. We had Mr. Senator Maziarz, Mr. Serretto, Legislator Corwin, and
Ray Walter.
And they all certainly supported an issue here that we're going to be discussing today, which is a proposed cutting to a lot of the funding from the state by Governor Cuomo. And there's certainly an appeal to have him reconsider this, and we're going to post this phone number on the bottom of this as we talk. So you can call the governor and say, hey, Gov, not here.
Right.
So the rose between two thorns here. It looks like it's a setup here, but we're going to let John introduce how we got to where we are.
What are our challenges here? And the challenges applicable to not only Niagara Cerebral Palsy Opportunities Unlimited River Shore, but all 700 agencies that receive funding through the Office for People with Developmental Disabilities throughout New York State. So it's not just in Niagara County. But looking at Niagara County and our three agencies and others throughout Western New York, we are faced with what is an unprecedented level of funding reduction, meaning a cut, to the services we provide to children and adults with developmental disabilities. That cut is a 6% cut. Now, 6%, when you look at the big picture, may not sound like a lot, but to us, that's absolutely devastating to have that level of a cut to our programs and services. We've provided services. We've been in operation for nearly 60 years. Back in New York State, back in the early 70s, there was basically a revolution in the services we provide because of a scandal downstate at a school called Willowbrook School, which really was an institution that warehoused people with disabilities. Ever since then, the field that we work in and the services we provide have been progressively improved, increased, so that people live more independently, their lives are enriched, they receive support from agencies like us. So we've built up what is known around the United States in New York State as a model service delivery system for people with disabilities. We're at the point now, though, with this proposal from the governor and his executive budget for the 2013-2014 budget, that this will be in severe jeopardy. Already in the last 3 years, we agencies like us have received a 9% cut over 3 years for our services and programs. But to have a 6% cut on top of that in 1 year is absolutely devastating. It will be drastic. It will lead to, and we'll comment on that shortly, but lead to potential curtailment of services, potential workforce reductions, because we simply, as nonprofit agencies, we simply don't have cash reserves or surpluses to make up that kind of a deficit. So we're up against it.
John, where does this come from then? The governor, the Senate, the Assembly, all the what?
Yeah, and defer to my colleagues here, but this is in the governor's budget. And so far, thankfully, we've had tremendous support from both the Senate and the Assembly in New York State. They've supported the restoration or elimination, if you will, of this cut in their one house budgets, their proposals to the governor. The governor, as of a few hours ago, still, however, is saying that he believes this cut needs to be in his budget. So,
John's absolutely right. I think the biggest thing is that we are appreciative of the Senate and the Assembly for passing this. And we all can say that. And there was a lot of work involved in the last week with counties all over New York State. I mean, we look at Niagara County, but this was going on all over the state. And we really got everybody on board, I think, to make sure that the Assembly and Senate passed it. We are very concerned right now because I was just saying before we started this that I thought that the governor would actually you know, look at that and say, okay, well, we need to relook at this. And it seems that he doesn't really want to move on this. And it's very distressing. It's very distressing to us who run these agencies and to the family members. You know, I think that people don't realize that the family members, you know, we at our press conference on Friday, we had a parent and one of our clients, you know, there and talking about services. What would these people do? You know, where would they go? Where would our clients go if we didn't have programs like ours? So I think that's the message we need to get to the governor.
Now, Jeff, many people will say, well, it's just 6%. You know, they go home an hour early. What's really involved? Maybe I'll ask all of you. What could happen to your agency, the services,
well,
if 6% was cut?
A lot of very concerning things, and it's important, too, for our community to know, as John was alluding to earlier, this has been playing out already over a period of a few years. So in the case of our agency, for instance, we've already had to eliminate 12 full-time positions, which, you know, are jobs in our community here that are very important to the people living in our community with developmental disabilities. In our case, we have about 140 employees. So that's 9% of our workforce over the last 3 years we've had to contract. And that affects everybody involved, the employees, but most importantly, the people that were depending on those employees. And so further cuts, as you can imagine, will cause us to have to consider additional workforce reduction. However, we've been pushed to a point now where that may become increasingly difficult or even impossible. So we'll have to look at other alternatives as well. Such, we've already had to curtail some of the benefits our employees had received in the past, and we may have to look at that again. We may have to look at wages. Many of our staff earn less than $10 an hour, and you know that there's also a movement to increase the minimum wage. We would struggle with a 6% cut to maintain wages above the proposed minimum wage that's also being advanced in the legislature. So we're not talking about workers who are overpaid by any stretch of the imagination. And our message really is not only this is a very serious concern, but we're not simply saying don't cut the funds and that's all we have to say about it. There are better alternatives for the taxpayers, for people living with developmental disabilities that can be carried out. And really, it's just the political climate that stands in the way. If the governor has the political will to accept what the legislature has proposed to him, then there can be changes made that will allow for these cuts to be averted, allow for more people with developmental disabilities who are waiting to get the services they're not getting right now, and do it at a cost lower than we're doing it currently. And the reason that I say that is because in New York, there is still a lot of money utilized to provide services through a state service system, which is substantially more expensive than the service system that is comprised of the not-for-profit providers. There are political issues attached to that, and the governor doesn't make those issues known. He doesn't highlight those issues to the public. But that is a betrayal of his obligation and his responsibility to the taxpayers. So we're here to expose that point and say, for taxpayers who think to themselves, well, you know, we do have to cut costs, we do need to tighten our belts, we concur 100%. As a matter of fact, we know exactly how to do it in a way that would benefit everyone involved.
You know, ironically, if this cut was to stand, and some of the agencies throughout New York State that are already teetering on the brink of insolvency or having difficulty operating with this cut, if they were to close their doors, the state is obligated by the Constitution to care for the individuals they can no longer care for if another voluntary agency like us does not take over that operation. And that would be done, as Jeff is referring to, at least double the cost. So that very savings they were hoping to achieve with this cut would be lost because the state-operated services would have to absorb that that group home or that day service, whatever it is, at double the cost, and therefore the savings is lost. And the message is, we're taxpayers too. We certainly don't want to see taxes go up or anything like that. But These are dollars well spent. These are dollars that we as taxpayers and as a society that helps the most vulnerable people in our society need to spend money on. And we don't have the resources like a school district. We can't raise taxes. We don't have surpluses like hospitals or other types of health facilities to rely on. We need to operate our services based on the funding we receive from New York State. A 6% cut will make it impossible to keep the level of services where it's at now. So,
well, if you look at the whole picture, you're not just talking the services provided to the developmentally disabled person, right, but the family
is able
to function with a regular job, yep, not worrying about them because she's in good hands with you guys. The very purpose of your organization is defeated.
Sure.
And you go back to a Willowbrook situation.
Oh, yeah. Throughout New York State, there's over 15,000 people on a waiting list for residential services. In Western New York alone, that number is over 1,000. These are people or individuals whose family members may no longer be able to care for them because of their own physical health, their aging, and so forth. There's nowhere right now for those individuals to go because the state has stopped development of residential opportunities. They're leaving it up to us to be creative and use dollars as efficiently as possible, which we've always done, to create new opportunities. But the state is not supporting us to do that. They're cutting back instead of giving us more resources to do that.
You know, the three of us combined to employ over 1,000 people in the county, and we also serve over 1,000 people in the community,
yeah,
that have developmental disabilities. So that is a major impact on our county alone. But you know, John and Jeff are right. When we get into the state-run facilities, we get a little upset when we talk about that, because we have said, I mean, I've actually said out loud that I think that the state should be in the business. And at our press conference last week, Assemblywoman Corwin made point to saying that too, that they need to relook on being in the business, because as John said, it's at least double the cost of what it costs,
yeah,
us to run our programs.
That's right. The state right now, mm-hmm, is serving only about 10% of the people living in New York who have a developmental disability, but they are using half of the available money to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really primarily attributable to the cost of the state workforce. Evidently, we can't afford that anymore. These are highly paid state jobs with very expensive benefits, and the governor is avoiding dealing with that issue for political reasons at the expense of the taxpayers, and worse yet, and most deplorable, at the expense of people living with developmental disabilities who are our most vulnerable citizens. They now will go without vital services in order to preserve high paid state jobs. And that's where we're at now.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think we can be polite about that any longer. Not when it means people are going to be left in destitute situations. That's not what our society should do. That's not the right thing to do. And so we're trying to expose the facts to the public. We want the governor to have to answer to those realities and those facts, and we hope that if that can be accomplished, that the governor will ultimately decide that he needs to do the right thing.
Data shows that 1 in 7 families are affected one way or another by the kinds of services we provide, the supports we provide. And it's kind of ironic. I just wanted to add a little irony to this, and that is that the governor's father, Governor Mario Cuomo, was the one, after the Willowbrook School scandal came up and everything changed, he's the one who pledged that New York State would always stand behind persons with developmental disabilities, that we will always be there to support them and provide quality service. Ironically, now his son is headed in the other direction and on a path to dismantle the things that we have been building up over the decades since Mario Cuomo was in office. So I think that's pretty ironic.
Wow, really? Well, after attending that press conference the other day, you know, I saw more than 100 people in that room. They were fired up. And if that was just a representation across the state of the type of people, the energy in that room, Governor, we're going to try to get this message to you, but let me tell you, if you want your ratings to go up, because they're not doing too good right now, Change your mind on this, switch it around, you're going to have a group of people that'll be behind you for a long time. So
and the telephone
that's my layman's point of view.
That's true.
Thank you, Craig.
And it's just a phone call. It's just a telephone call. The phone number is on the screen to the governor's office to say, do not cut these services by 6%. Simple. That's all one sentence.
Call the number or call the mansion after 3 in the morning and wake them up and wake them up.
And just to add real quickly on that, to make it crystal clear that on many issues they're not together, but in this issue the Assembly and the Senate, senators and Assembly persons are united across the state that they are supporting us, our agencies, in this dilemma.
And right, Democrats, Republicans.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Bipartisan support.
And you three.
And
you three together.
Yes, right. Absolutely.
And we thank them.
Yes.
So call the governor.